Ava DuVernay, thank you for sticking around for an extra question. I was struck by the fact that the words that come out of David Oyelowo's mouth as King in this film were not King's words.
Yes.
Those of us who are, know all these things, who are watching it saying, that doesn't sound like that speech
right.
on the steps of the State House. But you had to put those words in his mouth so they sounded King-like.
Yes.
Because you didn't have access to those
right.
speeches.
Well, very few people. There are only so many Gwen Ifills and Smarty Pantses around that know that those aren't the real words. Most people walk out of the film not aware that those are not King's actual words that David Oyelowo was speaking
really?
In the speeches. I mean, you know, most people don't know that Selma is a small town in Alabama. They think it's Oprah Winfrey's character or something like that. So no, we love kind of educating people to what it's about and illuminating this. But yes, the rights to those speeches are intellectual property of the estate, and those are already assigned to another filmmaker. We didn't have the money to pursue them. We, you know, they belong to someone else. So we had to...
Steven Spielberg, right?
Steven Spielberg, as I understand it.
Yeah. What
an amazing film that's going to be.
Yeah.
He's supposed to be making a film about the whole life of Cradle to the Grave. Oh. We took this 3 months. There's some pivotal speeches in there. And so basically what I did was break down the cadence, the rhythm of King, some of the tricks that he would use to get people going. But the real thing was just to get underneath the idea. What was he trying to say in these speeches?
And in some of the dialogue and conversations between him and Ralph Abernathy, I think, you almost hear a little bit of a mountaintop speech
yeah,
in one conversation.
Yeah.
And so you interpolated some of his other comments made at different times of his life.
Yes.
Into the dialogue.
Yes. Well, just, I mean, you know, trying to infuse it, again, with the spirit of the time, the spirit of the man.
How hard was that?
It was... You know what, it was less challenging because I just kind of got in pocket at some point and really just, you know, freed myself, untethered myself from the words. Once you do that and you really think about his ideas, which were bold, which were radical, which were exciting, then it's just me restating the ideas to you with a few different words. Look, I'm no king, but, you know, sharing these ideas is something that we should all be doing. And so I approached it like that and felt much more free to share what he was talking about.
One of the things I was most struck the first time I saw the movie is if you know the history, you know the history. And if you don't, it's okay too.
Mm-hmm.
You still follow the story.
Mm-hmm.
And that had to be intentional.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I didn't want to make something that was too dense for folks that, we don't want this to feel like spinach or medicine, right? And so, but I wanted enough in there for folks who do know the history to feel a little bit more of the nuance, to feel closer to the facts that they know to be true or the facts that were challenging in the films or asking the question, what are facts, right? But also for folks who knew nothing about it. You think Malcolm X never came to Selma. You didn't know he had three kids. You didn't know, four kids. You didn't know he was 39. You didn't know four little girls were really murdered. You don't know anything about it. You come in and you go on the ride and you come out knowing a little bit more about King, that he's more than I Have a Dream. He's more than the mountaintop speech. He did more than believe in peace and was assassinated. He was a living, breathing, radical, charismatic, dynamic man. And there's so much more to learn.
Thank you so much, Ava.
Thank you very much.